righteousness of God has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ, who all believe. There is no difference between Jew and Gentile, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by his grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of anointment through the shedding of his blood to be received by faith. He did this to demonstrate his righteousness, because in his forbearance he had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did it to demonstrate his righteousness at the present time, so as to be just and one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. Let us pray. Lord God, in this short time together, open our ears and our eyes to see your vision for this place and our part within it. Teach us, hear our prayers, and enable us for service wherever you might take us. To your glory, praise and glory. Amen. Everyone loves a good redemption story. Redemption is the second chance we're all looking for. Think about your favorite book or movie, and you'll probably not be surprised to see that there's a redemption theme in that story. This is why the Bible is the best-selling book of all time. The Bible is full of redemption stories. Basically, the Bible is a redemption narrative, and it's all about how you were given a second chance because of Jesus. And Paul sums up this narrative in Romans 3. For everyone has sinned, we all fall short of God's glorious standards. Yet God, with undeserved kindness, declares that we are all righteous. He did this through Christ Jesus when he freed us from the penalty of our sins. For God presented Jesus as a sacrifice for our sin, believing that we are all made right with God, when they believe that Jesus sacrificed his life shedding his blood. There are a couple of things that are important for us to consider. First, even though we all love a good redemption story about someone who gets a second chance, a lot of people ignore the redemption Jesus offers. My question is if everyone loves a redemption story, then why is there so much hatred in the world against Jesus? Jesus said, "If the world hates you, remember it hated me first." You would think that everyone would love Jesus because his kindness and love that he displayed by dying on the cross. What is it that the world hates so much about Jesus? Why can the world not accept the second chance that Jesus provides us to live with God? I think the answer is simple. We don't like to be reminded that we need the redemption. Jesus frees us from the penalty of our sins. What is the penalty of our sins? The Bible teaches us that death is that penalty. I can't tell you how many times I've heard somebody say this. Nice message today. There were some folks who really needed that one, and I really want to say, I'm sure you did. But I don't have the guts. But now you know what you're thinking if you ever say something similar to anyone. We're all sinners. It's easy to pick apart the simple things that other people do and talk about them, to judge them, to make fun of them. But it's not so easy for us to examine our own sinfulness. I struggle with the reality because of my sin. I'm guilty before God, I don't deserve to live with him, and I can't be made right because of God, who I am and what I do. There is nothing I can do or say that would make God declare me not guilty. I am guilty. I deserve to die for my sins. This is where Jesus steps in. Because I'm a follower of Jesus, God declares me not guilty. God gives me a second chance because of Jesus, and this is where a lot of people trip up with God. They want the second chance, but they don't want the life that goes along with belonging to Jesus. They want the redemption, but not the righteousness. They want the tolerance of God, but they don't want to trust his word. They want the humanity of God, but they don't want anything to do with his holiness. This redemption, this idea behind redemption that the world rejects, it's messed up. In 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 2 says, God the Father knew you and chose you long ago, and his spirit made you holy. As a result, you have obeyed him and you have been cleansed by the blood of Jesus Christ. Most people don't mind the redemption part of the narrative, but the part about being obedient to Jesus, a lot of people don't like that. Second, if we make the choice to deny our selfish nature and follow Jesus, we discover who God is. There's a lot of people who write books and opine on Bible stuff, but just because a person received a doctorate degree from an Ivy League school and wrote a book about it, but who they think God is doesn't make them right. God gives this wisdom to those to seek and obey his Son. Seek Jesus first. If you look at the red letter words in the New Testament part of your Bible, you'll discover what God really wants for your life. Every person who is a follower of Jesus Christ is made holy by the nature of God. We point our lives to him and we make God the center of everything we do. Everyone around us knows who Jesus is because of everything about our life is in him. We are all his church. When God's people show up to do God's stuff, the way God shows up, the way God wants, God shows up in that power. You might be thinking, this is just too much for you. Who can live up to this standard? But that's the point. You can't. I can't. Only Jesus lived a perfect life. We are told in the Bible that God gives us everything we need. We have the same power that raised Jesus from the dead. Think about that. Jesus was dead. He wasn't breathing. He didn't draw breath for 3 whole days. His echo would have flatlined. Defibrillation would have been in vain. Jesus was dead. And a power brought him back to life. That power is indescribable because there is nothing in science or on earth that we can point to that makes sense of it. And that power lives in you. The Spirit of God who raised Jesus from the dead lives in you. And just as God raised Christ from the dead, he will give you the life in your mortal bodies by the same Spirit living within you. This is about God. This is about God's power. This is about God's work. I want to see the power of God displayed in my life and in this community. I want to use the gift of salvation that God presented to me so that his glory may be revealed around me. When we were in New York City on Global Vision, we had an opportunity to travel to Harlem. It was kind of scary, it was snowing, it's cold, but it was fun. We got to visit an organization called Exodus Transitional Community. The idea for Exodus was first scribbled on napkins as Julio Mendina walked down the halls of Sing Sing Correctional Facility in New York, where he had been sentenced to 12 years in prison. Julio watched as men were released from prison, only to return soon after with tales of discrimination, economic instability, and lack of support. It wasn't long before Julio realized that freedom does not promise prosperity. Rather, it promises a challenging period of transition, which very few are provided the guidance, the resources to secure housing, to find employment, to reconnect with family, to pursue further education, and address substance misuse, and to adapt to all the changes during one's separation. In his understanding, the return home was very similar to the Book of Exodus, wherein Hebrews were freed from bondage, yet must wander through the wilderness for 40 years before reaching the promised land. In March of 1999, just 3 years after returning home, Julio founded the Exodus Transitional Community with the help of one volunteer and a generous donation by their supporting founders. Since then, they have grown from a one-room office in a small inner-city church to a multi-location justice organization, serving thousands of New Yorkers every year. Though grounded in their reentry programs, Exodus Transitional Community now offers a broad spectrum of services for adults and youth affected by the justice system. And they are proud to lead the policy and advocacy efforts that promote positive change in our communities. This organization is bringing people back from a world where they feel disconnected and stuck in an unending cycle. This is the place where they can feel the love in Jesus, and for a lot of them, they feel like they're not alone. And this is the first time that they've ever really felt the love of Jesus. Julio Mendina is using the power that God gave all of us to bring people back to life. No, they were never dead like Jesus was, but they were dead spiritually and emotionally. They were stuck. They couldn't move. Every time they would get out, something would happen and they would have to end right back in because they didn't have the resources they needed. But Julio is helping to stop that. Redemption. It feels good to get a second chance. We learn a lot of great stuff that way. The world is hurting and lost, and I hope that you are encouraged by the word of God today to seek Jesus first, to be like Jesus to this hurting and dying world, so that they may have an opportunity to use his gift just like you do, so they will discover God and experience their own redemption story. What's your story? Lost it. Let us pray. Lord, lead us this place Let us leave this place with love in our hearts and confidence in your words so that we can tell the world of your saving acts, so they may draw closer to you, and so they can share their own story. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Our hymn of decision today is Amazing Grace. It's in your hymnal, page 378.